So in this talk, I'm going to be looking at systems that aren't supposed to fail. And this isn't really the world that most of the security universe is focused on. But I'll give you a little bit of background of what got me focused on this, then talk about where the failures that we struggle with and the problems that we're struggling with come from, and the things that we do to try to deal with them. So let me actually start with a picture from this is an actual gift that was given to a bunch of us who've helped Microsoft with various security issues or doing crypto work, that he gave a dinner to tell us about on Monday to tell us about the great security things that they're doing. And they actually are doing some fantastic stuff. This gift not being one of those things. If you look at this, there are 100 possible combinations for securing your data here. And it's insecure by default. The password was 00 in all of these that they handed out. And when it's locked, your data is still accessible. And, of course, there's a little manufactured in China sticker. If you wanted to make this up, you couldn't have come up with some better example of what's wrong with a lot of security systems. They look really great. The marketing department had lots of, you know, certainly produced something that looked really slick here, but yet it really accomplishes absolutely nothing. And no, I didn't plug it into my laptop to see what on earth was loaded onto it. So the genesis of this talk in some ways goes back to when I was working on the SSL protocol 14 years ago. And soon after that, there were some papers written that proved that big parts of the protocol, quote unquote, were secure. There actually was a flaw found in the protocol that I'll talk about a little bit later that all of those proofs missed, which is actually a really interesting lesson in a number of different ways. And I'll talk about that in just a bit. And then I was sort of staring at that little lock icon on the browser and something was bugging me. And looking at the list of all of the different CAs and companies, any of which who screws up and the whole thing just kind of collapses into a pile of dust. And then I went and I downloaded VeriSign's certification practice statement. And I'm picking VeriSign because they actually do it better than just about anybody else. And it's this big, long document basically saying that if they make a mistake, it's not their fault. And then you look at the configuration, and there's all these different configuration options that I know what they mean mostly, not entirely, and then imagine what an average user is going to do faced with all of these different choices and buttons that they can click, and then they hit OK, and then those buttons are just going to sit there with whatever they selected for the rest of the time they're browsing for eternity. And then it's all running back to some web server. I know nothing about where that web server is going to take my credit card information, and it's all running on top of Microsoft Windows. And I got really depressed, because here you have a protocol which, subject to a few little asterisks, is secure, but yet we can't say anything at all about what we accomplish. And so starting at about this point in my career, I started diving down levels in layers of abstraction. Instead of dealing with protocols, I started looking at software, and then I got frustrated with software and started looking at what you could do in microprocessors. I got frustrated with microprocessors, and now almost everything I'm focusing on from a research perspective is in hardware, where I'm working at the gate level and sometimes below the gate level, because it's the only place where I can say anything at all about the security I'm dealing with. Again, a horribly depressing situation when you have to go and basically wire up individual gates to know what's going on. From a corporate perspective, it's actually been great. We're the biggest and the dominant semiconductor security R&D company. We license about 4.5 billion chips a year. So if you get a security chip, for better or for worse, stuff that we've worked on is going to be in there. In addition to that, we've worked on a lot of systems that are both very high assurance and very low assurance. At the low assurance end of the spectrum is a system we built as part of the Blu-ray standard, whose entire job is to basically allow recovery and re-update of security code after failures occur. So trying to go for the other end of the spectrum than what I'm going to be talking about today. Now, when I say low assurance, people have different understandings of what the word assurance means. So in some ways, it's easier to say, what is low assurance? This is a system that has defects. If somebody looks hard enough, they're going to break it. And it's really just a question of whether the adversary is going to invest enough effort. If you take a PC running Windows XP or even Windows Vista, you plug it straight in the internet and you start doing anything useful with it, it's just a matter of effort for the attacker to break what you're doing. If they can send the right packets in, find the right bugs, they'll find something that will let them take over your machine, get all the data on it, do whatever they wish to your platform. So it really becomes a race when you're dealing with the low assurance end of the world. And this is what most all quote-unquote security systems are coping with. Here you've got it's a question, will the attacker find the vulnerability before you patch it? Or will the attacker just be so lazy they're never going to find it at all? Now, there are times where this is absolutely the right way to build your systems, because if the consequences of an attack aren't that bad, you know, somebody gets to see your homework assignment that you haven't turned in as a teenager, okay, the world isn't going to come to an end. If the attacker resources are very limited, so the complexity of digging through that code to find those bugs is sufficiently high that the attacker is just not going to bother. Again, it's certainly fine to be low assurance there. If you have project complexity, I'll talk about complexity more in just a few minutes, that makes it impossible to do anything else, then that's what you have to do. And the last thing that's really important is you need to have reliable infrastructure to recover from attacks. So Windows Update is probably the best example, but obviously everybody here has dealt with patching. So in order for the update process to work, though, you have to know that you were broken. You have to be able to have an update mechanism, and you have to have engineers in place that can actually do that additional re-engineering. If you're missing any of those three, then you've got a serious problem on your hands. Now, there are lots of places where this doesn't work very well. So if you're building a payment smart card and you've got a bug in your protocol, and I'll talk about the EMV problem in a little bit, that's a really nasty problem because you can't go out and easily replace absolutely everybody's credit card just with a new update. There's not an update mechanism where you can push software out to these things. When you've got devices that plug right into the edge of the network, so they're facing all the malicious traffic in the world, essentially, you need to make sure that the software isn't going to have bugs that let it be taken over. For anti-piracy systems where people make a living breaking these things also, you get faced with tremendous degree of attacks, or we model it as pressure. You can think of it as like water pressure in a system. ASICs, another example. The hardware chips we build, you can't patch them. You put it in silicon. The masks get made. You spend millions of dollars on your masks. Billions of these things ultimately get produced. And if there's a bug in there, there's nothing you can do about it ever. Now, the flip side of it is if it works correctly, there's not really any way that the attackers can modify what it does, which is the good side. But the bad side is that there's nothing you can do about it to fix your problems. And then there are things like dishwashers. We went dishwasher shopping recently, and they're putting web servers in the dishwashers right now in the same microprocessor that decides whether the drain is going to drain water out and whether the water is going to come on into the cavity. And for that kind of a system, I don't want to spend my afternoon installing software updates on my dishwasher because some prankster decided that it was time to turn all the valves on and the drains off. So for those kinds of applications, it's really important to make sure that because you're not going to actually get patches installed, that you build the software and the hardware right from the beginning. Now, if there's any way as an engineer you can get out of doing this, you should, because your life is going to become a lot less fun if you have to go through making sure that your software and your hardware don't contain bugs. It's much easier for an engineer or for an IT person to patch a bug than it is to prevent it. But there are times where you can't do that. Now, when you start trying to get rid of the bugs, one of the things that you very quickly discover is all of the odds are stacked against you. If you're an attacker and you find one way into a system and you fail 99% of the time, you're a hero. You're going to get in, you're going to be successful, you're going to get your data, you're going to get out, and people will view you as accomplishing what you were out to do. Whereas if you're a defender and you're successful against defending 99% of the attacks and you miss one little thing, you're a complete failure. So the odds for the attackers are great because any little mistake they can take advantage of. And security is determined by the weakest link. All of you have heard that before. That's the soft underbelly that I'm talking about in the title of this talk. The focus of what I'm going to be looking at here is to try to look at the areas where we found those weak points in systems where they weren't expected. And I would consider this talk a huge success if each one of you is able to find, by using some of the things I'm talking about, one significant problem in the systems that you're trying to protect and to get rid of these vulnerabilities in. So what the heck is security? That's the first thing I'm going to talk about here before I jump into this question of complexity. So security is at the opposite end of a spectrum from functionality. Security is about getting rid of functionality that you don't want to have there. Like if you've got a word processor and there's a bug in it and somebody can crash Word or make it do something that they shouldn't by typing the wrong things in, but they print their document out and it looks good, for the most part, that's functionality. It doesn't matter if there's some latent bug and some unused feature. At the other end of your spectrum, if you have a web server and there's some feature, quote unquote, that lets somebody send a maliciously crafted packet in that executes code remotely, that is functionality. In fact, it's very complex functionality because you can run something of arbitrary complexity in this process, yet that is the thing we're trying to prevent. So security is not functionality. So this question of what is the connection between functionality and security? If you look at a system, as the amount of functionality increases, the value of that system has diminishing returns because you put in the most valuable features first, and then you're sort of piling on the extra things that are less and less useful and more and more difficult to implement. Now, you find that your risk goes the other way. The risk goes up as the number of interactions between your components increases. So if you double the number of lines of code in a system, the likelihood that it will fail, given the same code quality and everything else, goes up faster than a linear as the complexity increases. So you end up with a net benefit for an ordinary system, which goes up and then sort of peaks and falls off. And there are things we can do to change this curve somewhat by using better tools to get rid of bugs and so forth. Now, when we go to a system which is high assurance, we have about the same curve when we're dealing with utility, but the risk goes up a lot faster, because instead of having it be a minor inconvenience if we have a vulnerability, suddenly it's a catastrophic, horrible, sort of end-of-the-world kind of problem. So we end up with our benefit curve dropping off much, much more rapidly. The main sort of lesson that comes away from this, and in fact, if there's nothing else you get from this talk other than this one slide, this should be the one thing to remember, that unnecessary complexity is a security flaw. It's not necessarily even the bugs in the complexity. The fact that you've got that complexity there to begin with means that your system is not going to be able to achieve its security benefits. Now, as you're coping with complexity, one of the things that you realize is that if you look at any sort of a system, whether it be neurons as they go to becoming brains, or ants going to colonies, or TCP/IP becoming the internet, you have these individual building blocks that your mind can grasp. You know, I understand what the individual instructions are in x86 assembly language, and I can tell you what each of those instructions does, but a very complicated piece of code, I have no ability to map that low-level understanding to a similar level of comprehension from the complex system that's built from it. So we end up with this insecurity being this emergent property that comes about with our complexity. And our brains are going to trick us. They're going to think that because we understand these low-level building blocks, we understand the system that we're built with them. And the approach that I've taken in my career of trying to deal with this risk is to start pushing security down to lower-level layers where there are fewer degrees of complexity that I have to cope with. So going from network issues to applications to operating systems to CPUs and finally down to the low-level hardware. Now, there are lots of times where you can't do this. I mean, if you have to build every single application you're going to do out of raw transistors and wire them together, you're never going to get anything terribly complicated. So what do you do? Let me give an example of what we do for our internal network at my company. So the basic problem we have is we have applications like email that go to the outside world. We have a company network. We have various services like printers and backup and so forth and user PCs. And then we have some really critical data that we want to put on those PCs. The usual way that you'd go about dealing with this problem is to start putting security elements in place, so adding features or functionality to the network. So putting firewalls in, putting in intrusion detection systems in, putting in compliance rules, putting in password policies and servers along with that, user education, antivirus, starting to spend money trying to lock down this thing. There's an alternate approach that we ended up taking because this was never going to get us the degree of assurance we needed, and it was going to be a tremendous pain in the neck. So what we ended up doing is we gave everybody a different PC. One PC with the critical data on it, one PC for things like web browsing, and we have a private network with an air gap. Very, very simple approach. It's actually very inexpensive. You only need to buy a little extra hardware. And we can get a vastly higher confidence in our security than by going out and spending $250,000 on the gear that's being sold on the show floor here. In many ways, this is the slide that security vendors don't want you to see because their products, despite costing you a lot of money, can't give you the same kind of security assurance that you can get by just cutting a network cable with a pair of wire cutters. So it's very simple to verify. There's no way that data can go back and forth. There are a few things you have to worry about, like unexpected radios buried in equipment. But for the most part, the complex risks that we were dealing with in the model where you've got lots of machines with sensitive data on them and also external access largely go away. It's also important to note here that users understand why it works, which means that everybody understands why it's secure and what they are and aren't supposed to do. It's very intuitive what's supposed to happen. So you can get actually much better compliance with a system that users understand than one that they don't. Now, I should note here that my earlier comment about complexity being an insecurity, being a flaw, was a little bit of an oversimplification because of something that we've done here. It's okay to have complexity if it's properly encapsulated. So here we have the complexity in our private network, yet there's no way that complexity can compromise the data because we've been able to put a very clean and simple boundary around it that we understand. So when we go and we look at systems that we're working on in our services group, we almost always find that the reason that we have failures in those systems goes back to the design stage. So I'm going to talk a little bit here about what architectural approaches are the most successful and which ones are the ones that tend to lead to failures. So as you look at an architecture of a security system, there are three different perspectives that we look at as we're going through trying to understand the design. So the first is looking at it from a communication perspective. What information is going from what point to another? So what is the data crossing the various boundaries or going between the participants? And you can model in almost any kind of a system from a communication-centric perspective. And then the security question you ask is, what restrictions can we place on these communications? So the example I gave earlier of an air gap network is the cleanest and simplest example of all. We are saying that there shall be no communications across this boundary. We're going to base our security architecture on that. A second way that you can model a system and get a similarly comprehensive understanding of what's going on is to look at what information is present and what is it that defines the current system state. So as you have somebody going through a protocol, what are the different states that they can be in, and when do those states change and when do they merge? And I'll talk about state merging in just a second, because that's a really common area where things go wrong. The third way to look at a system is from a functionality perspective. So this is, you know, what is the software? What is the logic in here? What are the algorithms that are being used? And how are they implemented? Now, I'm going to talk about when you look at each of these perspectives, you see different things in a system and you find different vulnerabilities. So first of all, if we look at this from a communication perspective, so what you're looking at the protocols that make up a system, what you see going over the wire, there's some really important questions to ask. So the first thing is that when you go and you do a security review of a system, if there are things that aren't well-defined, like somebody's not really gone down to the bit level and said, what are the fields that are going back and forth, you know that you're likely to find a problem there. The next thing you look for is the error handling, because it's really easy to define the way things are supposed to work, but nobody likes to define exactly the way that things are supposed to not work. So if you find that there are ambiguous error handling outcomes or places where error handling reveals information, those are interesting. In fact, some of the early SSL implementations were revealing reasons why public key operations were failing. That was actually leaking a little bit of information out from them. So you can actually end up with most definitely security bugs resulting from this. You look at the message flow to see if it's consistent with the security expectations. You look for anything missing or undocumented. You look for the crypto. I'll talk a little bit later about crypto, because that's certainly something that where I probably see a disproportionate number of crypto failures, given that cryptography research, you know, crypto is kind of what we do. But certainly it's something where you want to look carefully there. Input checking, looking for redundant fields. That's another area where you find a huge number of security issues. So if a protocol has somebody send, for example, the date in two different places in the protocol, and then later something is using that date field, the implementer now has this question of, which date field do I use? And then the attacker has the question of, okay, great, why do I have to send the same date twice? And so the implementer then has to check to make sure that they're the same, and you've gained absolutely nothing by sending this redundant information. All you've done is create a whole bunch of interesting opportunities for somebody to attack you. So when you see the same information being conveyed in two different parts of a protocol, there's usually something nasty that's going on, or at a minimum, you've got some unnecessary extra complexity that's been added. And then you look for things that are being left to the implementer, because if you're the designer, you basically assume the implementer is malicious. Don't give them any benefit of the doubt. Just assume that they're going to screw everything up that they possibly can. And then there are things like revocation checking, code updates that also you may or may not need to have in there. And the last sort of thing on this slide is the question of versioning. So I can't count the number of times where you've had a system that gets rolled out, there are problems in it, and then nobody put any plan in place to actually roll forward to a subsequent version of the system. So in your protocols, is there a way to securely authenticate which version is in place? In the SSL 3, there's a really gruesome hack that I did with RSA padding where you could kind of put a side channel leaking a little hint to somebody that you're an SSL 3 capable implementation when you're running SSL 2, and I'm still embarrassed about that. But it was the only way to do it, because SSL 2 had absolutely no plan in place for any way that you could have any protocol beyond that. So the next area that I talked about earlier is looking at the state. So where is the data in the system? You know, looking at the data primarily at rest. So the first question that you always look for as you start going through a protocol going through a design is, what are the critical data structures? Are they defined? Is it clear what the bits are? You know, is it? I mean, just saying that we have an integer here, but you have no idea whether it's a, you know, 10-bit integer or an X509 thing where your integers can be, you know, 2 to the 128, 2 to the 512, these kinds of numbers, and it's fine. You know, what does that structure look like? Are the data structures too flexible? So ASN1 X509 certificates are a great example of this. I have never done an in-depth security review of an ASN1 certificate parser and not found a security bug in it that was serious. The formats are so complicated that it's almost impossible to get them right. And it's also a horribly tedious process implementing this stuff. So anybody who can get out of it will. I mean, if you're in a meeting, whoever gets assigned the job of writing the ASN1 parser is the guy who doesn't have the political pull to get some more interesting job. So you almost always find problems when you're parsing these really, really nasty, gory data structures. So what are the access rules and partitioning restrictions? So where is this data? You know, what are the sort of hard pieces that go around it that are part of that state? And then what are the transaction states that exist? So if you're looking at a protocol, you can diagram out the different stages in that protocol and figure out, okay, I'm waiting for this message. How do I get to this state where I'm waiting for this message? You know, what are these states? How do I get there? And I'll talk about some bugs on that on the next slide. With respect to those states, the most common place where you have failures is where states merge. And I'll talk about that in the next slide here. You want to look at if it's clear how the data is stored. Is it on the hard drive? What are the properties of that storage? Is it an EEPROM? What happens when that EEPROM's write cycles are exhausted? Is it in flash memory? What happens if you interrupt a write and your state suddenly data all gets wiped to zero because your flash doesn't erase and then fills in everything? So where that data is stored, how it's stored, is critically important. And then you need to look at this from cradle to grave, because security isn't something where you create a product, you ship it, and you're done. I'll talk about that a little bit later. And then last, who can touch that state? So you've got your data object here that's really important. What code, what processes, what hardware has the ability to manipulate that? The problem that people seem to be missing, perhaps more than anything when it comes to looking at transaction states, particularly in protocols, is the case where you have two different ways of getting to the same point. And in almost all protocols, this is a necessary thing to be able to do. But the implications of this are really subtle. And there have been some problems recently found in some really mature protocols in the way that this is done. And so two examples that I'm going to talk about right now. First of all, there was a bug that was recently found in SSL v3 and TLS. And so in 1996, when I was designing the protocol, I made it so that there were basically two ways you could get to the point where you're extending data back and forth. One is through the initial handshake that you do. Another was through a process where you could renegotiate your security parameters. And this was included so that you could initially negotiate some cipher settings and then upgrade to something higher if you wanted to. So there were some privacy and anonymity requirements that was really useful for. What somebody discovered recently was that you can get the handshake process and the renegotiation process are similar enough that it's possible to trick somebody into taking over a session you've already created by doing a handshake session with a server and then giving the unsuspecting victim the other side of that protocol. So you can, as a result, inject data at the beginning of an SSL transaction, then hand that off to somebody else, and they think that they've got a fresh transaction or a fresh channel that's been opened up. So here there were two different ways to get to the same point. And when I designed the protocol, this was not something that I thought about properly. And interestingly enough, there also have been a large number of papers even proving correctness of these constructions that missed this. So it was something that people just haven't been thinking about properly. There's also an interesting attack that Ross Anderson and some of his students did looking at problems in the EMV protocol and more precisely at the way that EMV transactions are actually being processed in the back end. And there are basically two ways in EMV. Well, there are actually hundreds of ways in EMV, but two that he was looking at, where you can get to the point where you have successfully authenticated a transaction. One is by doing a PIN verify at the beginning. The other is without a PIN verify. And it turns out that if you put a man in the middle between a card and a terminal, and you make the man in the middle skip the PIN verify process of the protocol and just tell the terminal that the PIN verify was successful, the subsequent transaction proceeds correctly. So again, we have two ways to get to the same process of having the device output its conclusion that the transaction is valid or the authentication data for the transaction, yet there was no binding between that output and the process that was used to get there. So as you look at systems, whether it be as simple as a restaurant where you're trying to secure the seating process, where somebody can walk in and just sit down at a table, or the greeter takes them there after they've waited in line, you know, you can have a security failure and something as simple as that, all the way up to these protocols, because there are multiple ways to get to the same point. And in almost all cases, what the adversary wants is to get to the secure objective without having gone through the normal path. Now, the last thing, the one that I've saved for last here, is this question of functionality. And this is by far the hardest to limit, and it's the one that we spend the most of our time and energy and blood, sweat, and tears trying to cope with. So it really, at the end of the day, boils down to whether there are bugs. And there are things that we can do that reduce the density of bugs in a system. So if you get a code evaluation tool, and it will go through and look for unsafe things, that will cut your bug density down. If you do code reviews, that will cut your bug density down. Each of these things helps, but complexity overwhelms you eventually, and you will never get your bug density or your bug probability down to zero. It's just a question of how much money and how much effort do you spend doing these things? How is your architecture architected to make it so you can do these things more efficiently? And at the end of the day, you have some probability that your system is going to fail, and that is not going to be zero ever. Now, in a sort of the nice, clean theory world, your goal is to work at least until your incremental risk reduction equals the incremental cost. So you want to look for the low-hanging fruit first and clean up those areas and review them and keep going until it's not worth going further any farther. Now, in reality, it's really hard to do this, because if you knew where the areas of greatest vulnerability were, you know, the bugs, you would walk straight to those, you'd go fix them, and you'd suddenly be able to do this much more effectively than we ever can. So you end up spending, you know, 99% of your time basically stumbling around in the dark, looking at stuff that's designed properly, searching for those occasional little places where there are little nasty things lurking. And the only thing we can hope to do is to stumble more effectively. And what in many ways the goal of this talk is to do is to tell you the places that we've stumbled around, stubbed our toes, found interesting things, so that those can get a little bit more attention. Now, as you deal with computational processes or with functionality, you're trying to deal with security in those, again, there are a number of different questions that you want to look for. So what sorts of initialization and cleanup steps are there? So where, as the system is getting born, whether it be in manufacturing or as the system is dying and you're decommissioning, what's going on through that process? You look for the corner cases in the software. So error handling routines in particular are a really great one to look at. What operations are accessing the critical state directly? And then you want to look at sort of whether the operations and process flow is even well-defined at all. So if you can't even figure out what the state machine looks like and what the process flow looks like for a given transaction, you're very likely to have an implementer who's going to do something that they shouldn't. You want to make sure that the blocks individually are testable, that they make sense, they stand by themselves, that there aren't really nasty things that are getting crossed between blocks, because the interactions between blocks are where a lot of the problems lie, and I'll talk about that again in just a little bit here. When you open up the specification, one of the things that tells you a lot about what you're going to find in a security evaluation is whether the spec is complete. So if you've got things like flowcharts and pseudocode and well-defined function names, names for variables, well-defined operations, you're much, much more likely to end up with a system that for which major things have been not been missed than for a system where those are not carefully specified. You want to look for ambiguity. So anywhere where the implementer has a choice, you want to assume the implementer is going to choose the dumbest choice if you're doing the evaluation or if you're the designer. And then looking for inter-block interactions. And I'll talk about interactions in just a little bit. Now, once somebody has taken the spec and turned it into code, or even when you're testing it at the specification level, the most difficult question to ask in all of security is whether there are any bugs in a system. And you know, my company frequently gets asked to review giant code bases, and we generally turn these projects down because there's no way that we can take a million lines of code written by the lowest bidder with comments on some foreign language and go through and tell our customer exactly which lines of code in there have bugs in them. There's just no way to do that. Even if there was a way to do it, the engineers that I've got on my team would rebel and quit their jobs long before they'd go through and deal with this. It would make more sense to go and re-implement the code from scratch to make sure that it was doing what it was supposed to do. So testing and verification is an extraordinarily difficult problem, and I have a tremendous amount of respect for the people who do it. testing is not an afterthought. It's not second class to design. In fact, the testers have to do much more difficult things than the designers do in many cases. It's usually underappreciated, and it requires a great deal of skill to do well. So if any of you are responsible for testing and validating systems, show your boss this slide. If you're not being paid enough, you should be paid more. Believe me, it's a very, very difficult job to do. Now, the architect has a role in this as well. There is no way that a tester can take a horribly designed ball of spaghetti and tell you whether or not there are security bugs in it. The architect has to build a system with testability as a primary objective, if not the primary objective. If it's not testable, it's the designer's fault, not the verification team's fault. Now, a very simple change at a very high level can end up making a tremendous difference in terms of the amount of verification that you can accomplish in a given amount of time. So, for example, the difference between using a safe programming language where you can't have pointer errors that can make one block subtly corrupt another one can make a tremendous difference in terms of what you end up spending in terms of resources in your testing and verification process later. So if there have been many times where we've worked on systems and people have started out going down a path where they've got some legacy code. Rather than rewrite that legacy code, they're going to stick with everything being used in an unsafe language. Yet, at the end of the day, the ultimate amount of resources that get spent are dramatically higher because of that decision. It's also worth mentioning the caveat that there are times where there's a conflict between testability and security. Most often this shows up in hardware, where if you've got things like scan chains, where you let somebody shift any data you want into your chip, run your chip for a while, shift the state out again. Now, those are exactly the capabilities an adversary wants. You're basically letting somebody come in, have free reign of your system, and then take out any information they want when they're done at the end of the day. So there are times where you have to engineer without things that you might like from a testing perspective. In fact, the secure chips we design, we build them without scan chains, which is utterly bizarre in the security in the semiconductor industry, but you have to do it. In terms of validation, you're going to spend a lot more money when you're dealing with a high assurance system on validation than you are in design. So everything you can do in the design stage that makes that easier is going to pay off very, very handsomely. So you need to be very, very suspicious at the design stage if there's something that's going to be really hard to test. Now, when it comes to testing, you've got this difficult question of where do you look? Because when you've got a complicated system and you've got finite resources, finite schedule, you've got to try to focus your energy in the areas that are most likely to have the bugs. Doesn't mean you should neglect everything else. But as you're looking through the design, there's some places and some questions you can ask that very often lead you to problems more quickly than if you're looking sort of arbitrarily over a large code base. So the first thing you start looking at is whether the security requirements that have been stated simply are met in general. So you look at things like if somebody is assuming that you've got a non-volatile memory and you're going to keep a failure counter in there and that the counter will get incremented atomically. You want to go look at the non-volatile memory update routine to see, okay, does this routine really update atomically in all cases, or if you have a power outage in the middle of an update, can you end up with some value other than what you intend, and more specifically, if you can end up with a value that's smaller than what you expected. You want to look at the design components that are planning for tests to see if they're adequately detailed and the test plans make sense and that you're able to and are actually planning to test the components appropriately. You want to look at the complexity of the design, make sure that if you're a tester, that if there's some horribly complicated way somebody's implemented something which shouldn't be as complicated as it is, that that goes and gets fixed. Because, as I said before, complexity is a security flaw. You want to look and make sure that the implementations can be verified and who will be doing that. You want to look for the locations of the test hooks. And finally, you're looking at this question at the test specification end, or sort of what are the odds, just even rough estimate, is it going to be reasonable to implement this thing correctly? If the business guys are requiring that it be unbreakable, if you've got millions of lines of code and limited schedule to get it together, the answer is no. And it's very important to make sure that you convey that at least as much as you can within a given organization. So one of the things that that many of you know already, but that doesn't happen very often in the real world, is that security designs are not entitled to have constitutional rights. They are innocent. They're not guilty until proven innocent. They're innocent. Play this backwards. I don't know. I'm confused. Assume that they're guilty until proven innocent. If you can't show that it's good, you need to be deeply suspicious of it. One of the things that's important to do as a consequence of that is to make sure that you encourage people to be asking those questions about whether or not you've got a problem there. There was one project we worked on a number of years ago where the test team had, there was this very complicated anonymity system for the bug tracking process. And this perplexed me a little bit. And it turned out that the engineers had all the power, and they would get furious at the designers for criticizing their work. And the the testers for criticizing their work. And the testers would get fired or would get demoted or get in so much trouble for criticizing the gods that they had to create this anonymity protocol in their system so that it was possible to have this criticism without life being so miserable for the testers that they would quit their jobs. Now, if you've got a culture where this is going on, you are just beyond dysfunctional. That is the exact opposite of what you want. You want to make it so that there's a incentive for everybody to cooperate, to figure out what those problems are and fix them early on in the process especially. Now, early on means that you're doing architecture reviews, you're doing them early. That's the time where you want to make sure that you involve the people who are working on interconnecting components, because at the architecture stage, if you make incorrect assumptions about one block and then you go build some other block based on that incorrect assumption, you're going to end up wasting a tremendous amount of resources. It's the architecture phase where you want to bring the verification team in to make sure that they're going to be able to do what they want to do. It's also the stage where if you're bringing in outside consultants, you get vastly more value for your dollar at the architecture stage than you do by the time you've actually got an implementation. So as you're looking at a spec or an architecture, there are a number of places where you can look for sort of loose threads where if you tug on the thread, some interesting property is going to fall out that will give you information about your security. So here are some examples of some of those things that I talked about earlier that if you start digging down, you'll find interesting things. So if you find, for example, that test cases only cover non-malicious inputs, they're testing the functionality, not the security, that's a sign that there's very likely to be something that if you investigate will lead to an interesting problem. If you find overly complicated, I talked about that earlier, that's a security problem. If you find that you have any sort of misleading or erroneous assumptions or statement in the spec, or if you have an ominous feeling about things, it's interesting. When we go in and we do a security review of an architecture, even before we've got more than a few pages into the spec, you kind of know what you're going to find. And it's because you have statements that are just not going to be right. Somebody's saying that they're going to achieve a security objective that cannot be achieved, or that they're missing the sorts of things that you would expect to see in an architecture. You look for setbacks where there are a huge number of corner cases. It's the corner cases where security failures tend to lurk, not in the normal, functional, easily tested paths. You look for places where the implementer needs to be really, really savvy to get it right. Because as I said before, if the specification author assumes the implementer is not going to make mistakes, that there are going to end up being bugs in that specification when it's ultimately implemented. You look for unreliable or failures, cases where failures can occur in unexpected ways. We look for things. So we're looking for the things that are latent elements of the specification where things can go wrong. The next thing that we do when we're looking at a specification is to look for the entire, sort of the big, ugly, practical problems that sit underneath to make sure that those have been thought through correctly. So there's some things at the top stage that impact development. But then as you go down through the lower levels of a system, there are things like personalization. So you know, where are the keys coming from? How are they? Who are the identities involved? How are things initialized? What's the enrollment process? Questions of what are the test vectors that will be produced? What kinds of evaluation and functional testing have already been done? What additional tests are planned for the future? You look at things in the key management component. So where are the keys generated? What does that random number generator look like? And for some reason, random number generators are things that people just love to come up with brand new ways of getting them wrong. So you always dig down there. And they're completely untestable because just about anything that comes out from a random function could be random. So it's almost impossible to ever be sure that there isn't a bug there. So you want to dig into that. Questions like scalability, the backup of the keys. One system we looked at, they'd done a beautiful job in splitting keys out so that you required, I think it was 4 out of 7 of key shares in order to be able to reconstruct the root key of their system. They put all of those key shares on the same kind of hardware token with the same battery that were manufactured on the same day. The battery had a 5-year lifespan. The system was designed to last for 20 years. And that was an issue that got identified. An extra backup was made. That backup is the only reason that system is able to still function today. Then there are little operational things, like, so what is the user support component look like? You know, what are the guys that are in the help desk actually going to see as their user interface? Are they going to be able to operate this thing correctly? These are all the kinds of things that you start digging into to look at the places where real-world systems are going to fail and figure out whether the architect has done the things that are lazy from an engineering perspective but push problems off onto these other layers. Now, when it comes time to do reviews of a system, we basically have two both very deeply flawed tools at our disposal. We have automated tools, code scanning systems, fuzzers, these sorts of things. They're great in some ways. They're very fast, they're very consistent, they're very inexpensive. They're, unfortunately, though, very limited and very uncreative. And then we have human brains to work with. And human brains give us that creativity and a very broad scope, but we're terribly slow. We are not designed for this kind of process. You know, if you ask somebody to go through a giant code base, you know, the first lines they look at, they're going to think about very carefully. Fatigue is going to set in. There's just no way that the human brain can tackle some of the problems that we would like to be able to accomplish here. So let me talk just a little bit about code reviews. They're when you're trying to deal with implementation bugs, they're an extremely valuable resource. You have to do them, but there are a huge number of limitations. So implementers who are doing the code reviews know their own systems the best. They know the corner cases best. They know the best ways to find the bugs in their system. So getting the people who know the system to go through and take a second look at it is valuable. It gives you some increase in confidence in the system, especially if you focus on the critical areas and if you're using sort of an attacker-type mentality. But the limitations here are that you're going to spend a tremendous amount of effort and you're going to miss problems. So if you're relying on code reviews to get your bug density down to zero, you're not going to be successful. So one of the things that you can do that you can use to either augment or as an alternative to code reviews is to do root cause analysis when you find a failure. So during your development process, you're going to identify bugs. Some will be security bugs. Some will be things that might lead to security bugs. Now, the worst thing that you can possibly do is to just go and fix those. I mean, you should fix them, but you need to do more than that. If you look at the way that the FAA handles aviation disasters, and this is what the FAA and FDA do is actually one of those are organizations that we try to learn from because they've been able to build, in general, safe, well-tested systems. When you have a plane crash, it's not like they go up and say, oh, dang, the plane crashed, and go home. A huge amount of energy goes into understanding why it crashed. In fact, I mean, the whole reason for a black box is to make it so that you have more information to do your root cause analysis. So you want to go and you want to identify the root causes. And it's very important to note that I pluralized the word cause here. There's not a root cause. There are almost always many things that went wrong that led to any given security bug. Now, the immediate cause is the obvious thing. Okay, there's a bug in this line of code, and we need to go fix that. But the other causes in general are the trail that lead you to other problems in the system. So why did that user make the error? Was more training required? You know, why wasn't it caught earlier? Were there more code reviews needed? Were there scanning tools that could have caught this problem that would find other problems of the same class? When you find a bug, there are almost always bugs of the same kind that are lurking there. Why did or didn't testing catch it? You know, are there design things that could be changed? Are there resources that could be reallocated to get a better likelihood of catching this kind of bug? What kind of communications breakdowns occurred? I'll talk about that in just a minute here. And then you also look at what worked. Why were you able to catch it? Can you do more of that? In almost all cases, security failures have one of the root causes being a communications breakdown. So you'll find that virtually every bug that you look at has a miscommunication across different groups of people, between companies, between teams working in different parts of a system. The worst cases are where you have different companies involved, large physical distances involved, time zones involved, different languages, different layers of abstraction, and different roles. So if you've got somebody who's implementing a library and somebody who's consuming that software library, you have generally a lot of communications gap between the people who are using this system and the people who are designing it. Likewise, if you're dealing with a big applications program, the people who design it will make one set of assumptions. The end users will not necessarily be aware of those. A related security risk is if you have people on the team who cannot communicate well. And so the mad, incomprehensible genius is the person that you do not want to have doing your security architecture. So it's really important to have somebody who can communicate what they're doing and what assumptions somebody can make about that. and also having the soft skills to negotiate the political issues involved in criticizing somebody's work, in explaining why there's a failure, and then being able to look at that as a constructive opportunity to do something about it. So if you're, when we interview folks, the three things that I look for are technical brilliance, fun to work with, and equally important are communication skills. If somebody can't convey their thoughts to me, I really don't want to have them trying to interact with a customer to solve their security problems. One of the things that's pretty easy to do, can actually reveal a lot of surprisingly useful information, is to just ask the engineers who are working on a project to write down what security-related assumptions they have made about other components, and then share that documentation with the people who made those other components. I can almost guarantee you that if you have a large project, you're going to get something really interesting and surprising that will come from that exercise. Quick reminder that when you're dealing with crypto, that's an area where things can go wrong. So here I took our logo, made a bitmap. If I encrypt it with CBC mode, it looks like this. If I encrypt it with ECB mode and then display it as a bitmap using AES, this is what I get. Now, you'd think, well, AES is unbreakable. And it turns out, yes, AES is effectively unbreakable if used correctly. But because of the way ECB mode works, you can still see our logo just fine through that. This is just a very simple example of the many, many, many things that can go wrong with crypto. And with crypto, it's exceptionally difficult to test because there's no feedback when you get it wrong. And the less you know about what can go wrong, the more confident you are in what you're doing. So you want to make sure that if you're using crypto, that you don't place excessive trust in elements that don't merit that trust. Here I've got a couple of cipher machines, the Enigma and the USM-209 that were used in World War II. Probably roughly comparable security. Maybe the Enigma's a little better. But the US knew the M-209 was breakable and used it appropriately. The Germans had absolute confidence in the Enigma. And for the Germans, that was an absolutely devastating mistake to make, placing too much trust in their security. Quick mention about certifications. They give a marketing benefit. Vendors want them because if they're inexpensive and they give an ability to sell product. But most products have security bugs. So you have, as a result, most certifications are simply certifying products that are insecure. Not a very useful thing. So a couple of things that you learn from this. First, if your goal is to improve security, certifications are generally a very poor use of resources. You'll spend a lot of time producing a lot of paper that gives you very little actual security benefit. Now, it gives you the ability to convey to somebody that you've done that testing, but it's really a marketing or external message you're able to give, not a good use of actual resources if your goal is to find and catch bugs. There's also some economic problems with certifications where they encourage basically the most lenient approval processes. So as a relying party, you have this very difficult process of keeping your certification processes honest. Other places to look for are places where you have choke points where data is going in and out, implementation flaws that are hard to see. I talked about boundaries earlier, areas of implementer distraction. So USB implementations, for example, in hardware devices are pretty boring to write the USB stack. Lots of places security can go wrong, so digging into pieces like that. And also places where guidance was poor. So anything suspicious, you want to go in and look at and dig into. Running out of time here, but here are a list of places where there have been little things that we found in systems that ultimately led to serious security problems. Each one of these by themselves wasn't an exploitable problem to begin with, but avoided the warranty in some way. And when you're building a system, if you find little things that don't look right, those very often conceal problems or lead to problems when you investigate them. One last sort of note is that the best thing of all that you can find when you're architecting a system is a place where you can add something which introduces no risk but improves security. So one of the things that we do in pay TV system chips is we add hardware that contributes to the decryption process but cannot compromise it, and build a system where multiple pieces, and there are multiple pieces, any one of which can cause the security to be good, and an adversary must break all of them. So in a network, if you have two firewalls and the data passes through both and the attacker has to break both to compromise your security, you can actually get this kind of property quite inexpensively and quite easily, and it gives you much higher assurance than you would have if you have just one component. So in conclusion, for systems where you can really manage the complexity and you have a huge budget and you're willing to go through a whole lot of work and you don't mind never sleeping at night again, you can achieve high assurance security. You know, we build chips where we take liability if they get broken. We're willing to do that because we have control over these things and we can do these. But the really depressing conclusion of all of this is that even when you succeed, you clean up a system, there are no more attacks going on, the attackers just go after somebody else. So from a very macro perspective, we're making no progress at all. We're hardening an occasional individual target, but as a from a global perspective, the bugs are being created faster than we're ever going to get rid of them, which is job security for all of us, but we're never going to be solving these sorts of problems. So thank you very much for taking the time. I think I'm out of time here, but if you have any questions, I'll be available in the back afterwards. Thank you very much.